Good morning, students. Today in our lecture we'll be discussing about the anatomy of the gluteal region. This is Dr. Yusuf from the College of Medicine. Here in the College of Medicine we'll try to concentrate on two specific objectives. The first one is enumerate the muscles of the gluteal region and give their actions and nerve supply. The second one is enumerate the structures deep to gluteus maximus muscle. So these two objectives are supposed to be covered in this lecture as well as even in the lab. So whenever we reflect the skin, when you remove the skin in any part, we come across two fascia, the superficial fascia and the deep fascia. Even in this region, in the gluteal region, we come across this superficial as well as deep fascia. But the thing is, here it is little more thicker compared to the other parts of the body, as well as even tougher, especially in the gluteal region. There is the superficial is much more thicker and tougher compared to the other parts of the body. Usually the superficial fascia is thinner. Then if you reflect the superficial fascia, then we come across the next fascia, that is called as the deep fascia. The deep fascia of this gluteal region, it encloses two important muscles of the gluteal region, the superficial muscles of the gluteal region. One is the gluteus maximus. Here you can see here, this is the picture showing the side of the thigh and the gluteal region. So this is the gluteal region and this is the thigh, and below will be the leg. This is the knee joint. So this is the gluteus maximus muscle, and the second muscle it will cover will be the tensa fascia lata. So this is the tensor fascia lata here, and behind we have the gluteus maximus. So these are the two muscles which are covered by the deep fascia in this region. It covers on either side, and between the two layers of the deep fascia, these two muscles will exist. Very tough above the gluteus maximus. If you see this gluteus fascia above the gluteus maximus, this deep fascia will be much more tougher, and it is superficial to the gluteus medius. This is the gluteus medius muscle. If we remove this gluteus maximus, then the next muscle we come across will be the gluteus medius, which is seen above the gluteus maximus also. And in this region, the deep fascia is much more tougher, and it covers the gluteus medius superficially and gives partial origin for this gluteus muscle also. It not only this gluteus muscle take origin from the hip bone, but also some part will even take origin from the fascia itself. The tensa fascia lata is seen from the lateral side of the gluteal region. You can see here, this is the tensa fascia lata, which can be seen much more clearer from the lateral side, and the gluteus maximus can be seen much more clearly from behind. So these are two muscles which we come across when we reflect the deep fascia. The muscles of the gluteal region, apart from this tensa fascia lata as well as the gluteus maximus, there are other muscles which we are supposed to know. So what is the arrangement of this muscle? The muscles here in this gluteal region are arranged in three layers. The first one will be the superficial layer, then there will be the intermediate layer, and then deep to that will be the deep layer. So there are muscles in this region are arranged in three layers: superficial, intermediate and deep. Two muscles which we have already seen, the superficial region are the gluteus maximus as well as the tensor fascia lata. Then if we cut this gluteus maximus, deep inside we can come across the muscles of the second layer, the gluteus medius, piriformis, obturator internus and externus, superior and inferior gemelli, quadratus femoris. All we will see in the next picture how exactly they will look. Then the upper part of the adductor magnus with origin of the hamstring muscle. Okay, so we have seen the superficial layer, gluteus maximus and the tensor fascia lata. Now we are supposed to see the muscles of the intermediate layer. So these muscles can be seen. This is the gluteus maximus, and when we cut this muscle, here it has been cut, and you can see the muscles of the second layer, that is the, this is the gluteus medius. Okay, so the gluteus medius, then we have the piriformis. So if you can see here, this is the muscle piriformis. Then a very important muscle of this region, then we have the obturator internus. If you can see here in this picture, this is the muscle called as the obturator internus, and on the opposite side, deep to that, will be the obturator externus. Then we have around that, there are two muscles, that is called as the superior and inferior gemelli. So the above this obturator internus, there is a muscle, small muscle called as the superior gemellus, and below we have the inferior gemellus. Together they are called as gemelli. Gemelli is plural and gemellus is singular. So there are two gemelli, superior and inferior, above and below the obturator internus. So this is the superior and inferior gemelli. Then we have, below that, we have a muscle which is quadrilateral in shape. That's what is called as the quadratus femoris. So here there is a muscle which is almost quadrilateral in shape, so hence it is called as the quadratus femoris muscle. Below that we have the muscles of the thigh, that is the adductor magnus. So here you can see here the adductor magnus muscle. So these are the two parts of this adductor magnus. We'll discuss when we discuss the thigh, as well as the hamstring muscle. Which are the hamstring muscle? This is the semimembranosus, and this is the semitendinosus, as well as this is the biceps femoris. These are called together the muscles of the back of thigh. They are called as the hamstring muscles. So this, a part of it, the upper part of these muscles are also form the part of the gluteal region. So this become the second layer. After the superficial layer, this is the muscles of the intermediate layer, that is the gluteus medius, piriformis, obturator internus and externus, superior and inferior gemelli, quadratus femoris muscle, as well as the upper part of the muscles of the thigh, back of thigh. So here you can see again, this is the gluteus medius. When we cut the gluteus maximus, this is the gluteus maximus, which gives the contour to the gluteal region. So when we cut this, then we come across the second layer, intermediate layer muscles, that is the gluteus medius. Then we have the piriformis here. Then we have the obturator internus, and deep inside we will have the obturator externus, and above that we have this superior gemellus, and below that we have the inferior gemellus, then the quadratus femoris. Then we have the muscles of the thigh, and the upper part of the muscles of the thigh, which also constitute part of the intermediate layer. Then we have the third layer. If we cut this muscle, then we come across, if we cut even the gluteus medius, then we come across the next muscle, that is the, which form the deep layer, that is the gluteus minimus. Along with that, we can also see the reflected head of the rectus femoris and tendinous insertion of the obturator externus. As I said, the obturator externus can be seen when we cut this muscle, which is the obturator internus. So we'll come to the next layer, that is the deep layer, where we have the gluteus minimus, reflected head of the rectus femoris, as well as the tendinous insertion of the obturator externus. So these are the arrangement of muscles in the gluteal region. We have the superficial layer, intermediate layer, and the deep layer. So in the superficial layer, we have two muscles, gluteus maximus and the tensor fasciae lata. In the intermediate layer, where we almost have 5 to 6 muscles, gluteus medius, piriformis, obturator internus and externus, superior and inferior gemellus, quadratus femoris, as well as the upper part of the muscles of the thigh. Then in the deep layer, we can come across the gluteus minimus, as well as the reflected head of the rectus femoris, as well as the obturator externus. What are the nerves of this compartment, that is the gluteal region? We come across 4 important nerves here. One is the superior and inferior gluteal nerves, then the obturator nerve, as well as the nerve to quadratus femoris. So these are some of the muscles which will be supplying all these muscles in the gluteal region. So it is the superior and inferior gluteal nerves, obturator nerve, as well as the nerve to quadratus femoris. We'll see as well as discuss these nerves in detail later in the later stage. First, we'll discuss about these muscles and some of their important features, the origin, insertion and action, and nerve supply and all those things. The first muscle, the most important muscle of this region, is the gluteus maximus itself. So this is the most superficial muscle in the gluteal region and the most prominent muscle which can be seen from the side as well as from the back. So this is the gluteus maximus. So I have put all these muscles, all the muscles are here, and I have put it in a simple table form so that you can understand it in much better fashion. So here we have mentioned the origin, the insertion, action, as well as the nerve supply. The first muscle is the gluteus maximus. So this gluteus maximus will take origin from the back of the ilium. So this is the hip bone. This is the hip bone. This whole bone is called a hip bone, and this upper part will be called as the ilium. So this muscle, the gluteus maximus, will be taking origin from the upper part of the ilium as well as from the sacrum. So it will be taking origin from the ilium as well as this is the sacrum as well as from the coccyx. So the lower part of the sacrum, we have small coccygeal bones, 3 to 4 in number. So this form the coccyx. So it takes all, not only from the ilium, but from the also from the posterior part of the sacrum as well as from the coccyx. This is the picture seen from behind, as well as a ligament is there which is called as the sacrotuberous ligament. So there is a ligament which is extending from the sacrum up to this is called as the ischial tuberosity. So it goes up to the ischial tuberosity, that's why it is called as the sacrotuberous ligament. Then the erector spinae tendon, there is also a tendon from where it will be taking origin. So these are some of the areas from where it will be taking origin. So this is how it will be taking origin. This is how it looks like from behind. Okay. What is the insertion? Most of the if we divide this muscle into four parts, almost three parts will be going into the iliotibial tract. This is the modified deep fascia. We have already seen the deep fascia. A part of this deep fascia is modified and it becomes like a tract. So this is called as the iliotibial tract. So almost 3/4 of this muscle will be getting inserted to this tract, this modified deep fascia, and only 1/4 will be going to the gluteal tuberosity of the femur. So 1/4 will be getting inserted to the femur bone. There is a elevated part called as the gluteal tuberosity, and 3/4 of this muscle will be inserted to this iliotibial tract. So this is the iliotibial tract which will be running down up to the knee. So it is nothing but the modified deep fascia, and it acts as the tendon. The action of this muscle is very important. It acts as the extensor of the hip joint in extreme movement as well as anti-gravity muscle. So if you are sitting if you are sitting on a chair, and when you get up, this is called as the extension of the hip. This is called as the extension of the hip. And if you try to push your thigh backward, then it is called as the extreme extension of the hip joint. So it helps in the this muscle, gluteus maximus, helps in the it acts as the extensor of the hip joint in extreme movements. Okay, and also it acts as anti-gravity. If you get sitting on the chair or on the floor, and if you get up, this is the main muscle, gluteus maximus is the main muscle which help in pulling your body against the gravity. That's what is called as the anti-gravity muscle. This is the main muscle which help you from getting up from the chair upwards against the gravity. So that's why this is called as also called as the anti-gravity muscle. It also helps in it extends as well as laterally rotates the thigh at the hip. So if you see the hip joint, so at that exact joint it will extend. As I said, when you sit on the chair and get up from the chair, that is called extension. That it helps in extension of the hip joint as well as laterally rotate. When you flex the knee joint and try to rotate it outward. That is called as the lateral rotation of the thigh. So it helps in the lateral rotation of the thigh at the hip joint. And this is possible through the iliotibial tract. It also helps in the extension of the knee joint. So this muscle is, even though it is acting mainly on the hip joint, through the iliotibial tract, which I said it acts as a tendon and it crosses the knee joint and also helps in the extension of the knee joint. So this muscle is not only helping in the extension of the hip joint but also in the extension of the knee joint. And it also acts as the abductor of the hip. So if you are both the thighs are in median plane, beside the median plane, and if you try to bring it outwards, then it is called as the abduction. So when you are taking it away from this body center, then it is called as the abduction. So it also helps in the abduction of the hip joint. So it helps in the extension of the hip joint, it helps in the extension of the knee joint, as well as it also helps in the abduction of the hip as well as lateral rotation. What is the nerve which will be supplying this muscle? This is supplied by a nerve called as the inferior gluteal nerve. And these are the root values for this inferior gluteal nerve: L5, S1 and S2. So this is one of the nerves of the lumbosacral plexus, and this is called as the inferior gluteal nerve. This is the nerve which will be supplying the gluteus maximus. So you have seen this is the gluteus maximus. So this is the origin of this muscle and this is the insertion of this muscle, and we have already discussed the action as well as the supply. The second muscle, if you cut this gluteus maximus, the second muscle which you come across is the gluteus medius. This is the second muscle when you cut the gluteus maximus. This is the gluteus medius. So what is the origin of this muscle? This will be taking origin from the outer ilium between the anterior and posterior gluteal lines. So this is the ilium part, outside external part, and between there are two lines here. These are called as the anterior as well as posterior gluteal line. So it will be taking origin between the anterior and posterior gluteal lines. So it is taking origin between the anterior, and there is a posterior gluteal line, and then one more line is there, that is called as the inferior gluteal line. So this muscle will be taking origin, the gluteus medius will be taking origin between the anterior and posterior gluteal lines on the outer aspect of the ilium. And what is the insertion? It will be getting inserted to the greater trochanter of the femur. Where is the greater trochanter of the femur? This is the femur bone, and this is called as the greater trochanter, and this is called as the lesser trochanter. So this is getting inserted to the greater trochanter. This is the insertion of this muscle. This is the gluteus maximus medius, which has been cut to show the gluteus minimus. So you can see the origin of this muscle and the insertion of this muscle. So this is the gluteus medius. What is the action? It acts as the abductor of the hip joint and also helps in tilting the pelvis when walking. When you walk, the pelvis is supposed to be lifted and it has to be tilted upwards so that you can put the next step. So this muscle helps in not only abduction of the hip joint but also helps in tilting of the pelvis. It also acts as the medial rotator of the hip joint. This gluteus maximus helps in the lateral rotation, and this muscle will help in the medial total opposite movement of the hip joint, medial rotation of the hip joint. This muscle is supplied by the superior gluteal nerve. The gluteus maximus is supplied by the inferior gluteal nerve, and the gluteus medius is supplied by the superior gluteal nerve. And the root value for this is L4, L5 and S1. The next muscle is the gluteus minimus. If you cut this gluteus medius, then you come across the next muscle. This is called as the gluteus minimus. This is the origin of this muscle is also very similar. It will be taking origin from the outer surface of the ilium beneath the gluteus medius. So if you can see here, so it is also taking origin between the anterior and posterior gluteal lines on the outer aspect, but beneath the gluteus medius. The insertion is also similar into the greater trochanter of the femur. If you can see here, is getting inserted to the again to the glutaral trochanter near the gluteus maximus. Action, it acts as the abductor of the hip, as well as the anterior fibers help in medial rotation of the thigh. So it is very similar to that of the gluteus medius, and this is also supplied by the same as that of the gluteus medius by the superior gluteal nerve with the root values of L4, L5 and S1. Now the fourth muscle is the tensor fascia lata. We have already seen this muscle. This is the tensor fascia lata. So this muscle will be taking origin from the outer lip of the iliac crest. So this part is called as the iliac crest, and it will take origin from this part here, the anterior part of the iliac crest. It will be taking origin from the outer lip of the anterior part of the iliac crest. If you can see here again here, so it is taking origin from here, anterior as well as outer part of the iliac crest, and get inserted to the iliotibial tract. If you can see here again, this is the iliotibial tract, and it is getting inserted just like the gluteus maximus get inserted to the iliotibial tract. Even the tensor fascia lata will also get inserted to the iliotibial tract. So whenever these two muscle contract, then they help in the tensing of this modified deep fascia. Okay, this is the iliotibial tract. What is the action? Because it is on the lateral side, again it helps in the abduction of the hip joint, as well as it maintains extended knee joint. So whenever you are standing for a long time, then it helps in extension of the knee joint. So because it is crossing the knee joint, so whenever these two muscles act, then it helps in the extension of the knee joint. So one is it helps in abduction because it is on the lateral side, so it helps in moving away of the thigh away from the center axis. So it helps in abduction as well as maintain the extended knee joint. It is also supplied by the superior gluteal nerve with the root values L4, L5 and S1. Now the next muscle is the piriformis. This is the muscle here which is taking origin from the sacrum. So this is the posterior view I said. So it will be taking origin from the anterior surface. It will be taking origin from the anterior surface of the sacrum in the fashion of E shape. So this will be taking origin from the anterior surface of the sacrum. This we cannot see the anterior surface, and it will be taking origin from the anterior surface. So we cannot see the origin. So it is taking origin from the other side, and it is passing through this greater sciatic foramen and getting inserted to the again to the greater trochanter of the femur. In the picture also you can see here, it is getting inserted to the greater trochanter of the femur. The action of this muscle is it laterally rotates, it acts as the lateral rotator in case of the extended thigh. It helps in the lateral rotation in case of the extended thigh, and in case of flexed thigh it acts as the abductor. So it has two actions. One is it helps in the lateral rotation, the second is the abduction. But the lateral rotation is much more prominent when the near the thigh is extended, and if it is flexed, then it will be mainly helps in the abduction of the thigh. So the nerve supply of this muscle is by sacral nerves S1 and S2. Now coming to the next muscle, that is the superior gemellus. It is a small muscle here which you can see here. So this will be taking origin from a part of the ischium that is called as the spine of the ischium. So here if you can see here, there is a small spinous projection, and that's that is the area from where it will be taking origin. So this is called the spine of the ischium. So this superior gemellus will take origin from the spine of the ischium by lesser sciatic notch. So near that will be the lesser sciatic notch, below this will be the lesser sciatic notch, and the insertion of this muscle is again to the the upper margin of the obturator internus. And this obturator internus, if it is the muscle here, here is the muscle obturator internus, and this also get inserted to the great retrochanter of the femur. So just above that will be the insertion of this muscle. So in this picture, if you can see, this is the obturator internus getting inserted to the great retrochanter, and just above that will be the gemellus superior. So that get inserted there. What is the action? It helps in the lateral rotation of the hip joint, and the nerve supply is by the nerve to obturator internus. The nerve which is supplying the obturator internus, this is the obturator internus, this is the obturator internus, and the nerve which is supplying the obturator internus also supplies this superior gemellus. Now coming to the obturator internus itself, we have already seen this is the obturator internus. It will be taking origin from a foramen present here. This is called as the obturator foramen. So there will be a foramen here. This is the ischium. This part is the ischium, and here is the pubis in the front, and near that there will be a foramen here. This is called as the obturator foramen, and it is covered by a membrane called as the obturator membrane. And on this side is the obturator internus muscle, and on the opposite side will be the obturator externus muscle. So this muscle will be obturator internus is taking origin from the inner surface of the obturator membrane. I said obturator foramen is there here, and it is covered by a membrane called the obturator membrane. So this will be taking, this obturator internus will be taking origin from the inner surface of the obturator membrane. And the insertion, as you can see clearly, again it is going into the great retrochanter of the femur. What is the action? It helps in the lateral rotation of the hip joint, and it is supplied by the sacral plexus by the same nerve to the obturator internus. Next muscle is the inferior gemellus, which is present just below this obturator internus. This is the inferior gemellus. So this will be taking origin from again a part, important part called as the ischial tuberosity. This part of the bone, this is called as, there is a tuberosity here, this is called as the ischial tuberosity. So this muscle will be taking origin from the ischial tuberosity. Again, this also get inserted to the greater trochanter of the femur, just below the obturator internus. So here in this picture you can see here getting inserted to the greater trochanter, just below the obturator internus. What is the action? Again, this also has the lateral rotation of the hip joint, and the nerve is the nerve to quadratus femoris. This is supplied by the nerve to quadratus femoris. As I said, on the opposite side of the obturator internus will be the obturator externus. So in this picture, if you see here, what you see is the obturator internus, and if you see the opposite side, there will be the obturator externus. So this will be taking origin from the outer surface of the obturator membrane. So the obturator internus will be taking origin from the inner surface of the obturator membrane, and the obturator externus is taking origin from the outer surface of the obturator membrane. And this obturator externus can be seen much more clearly from the front, from the anterior view. This is the posterior view on where we can see the obturator internus. So the obturator internus will be taking origin from the outer surface of the obturator membrane and get inserted to the great retrochanter of the femur. So all these muscles are getting inserted to the great retrochanter of the femur. And the action is also similar, lateral rotator of the hip joint, and it is supplied by the obturator nerve. The last muscle here is the quadratus femoris. So this is the muscle which is called as the quadratus femoris, because depending on the shape, it looks quadrilateral in shape. That's what is called as the quadratus femoris. So this muscle will be taking origin from the external surface of the ischial tuberosity. So as I said, this is the ischial tuberosity here, and it will be taking origin from the external surface of the ischial tuberosity, and this will be getting inserted to something called as the intertrochanteric crust of the femur. So if you see here, these are the, this is the greater trochanter and this is the lesser trochanter. In between, on the posterior side, there is something called as the intertrochanteric crust, and if you see from the front, there is a line that is called as the intertrochanteric line. Inter means between the two trochanters. the greater as well as the lesser trochanter. So this is called as the intertrochanteric crest, and on the front we have the intertrochanteric line. So this muscle, quadratus femoris, will be getting inserted to this intertrochanteric crest. So the insertion will be into the intertrochanteric crest of the femur, and this also has similar action lateral rotator of the hip joint, and this is supplied by the nerve to quadratus femoris. The remaining muscles will be the muscles of the thigh, so that will be studying when we study the thigh. Okay, so these are the main muscles which are within confined to the gluteal region themselves. Okay, so these are some of the muscles we have studied. One is the gluteus maximus, we have seen. Then we have studied the gluteus medius as well as the minimus. Then the piriformis, superior and inferior gemellus, obturator internus, and on the opposite side we have the obturator externus, and this is the quadratus femoris. Now there is the second objective where we are supposed to cover the structures deep to the gluteus maximus. So when we see this gluteus maximus, deep to that there are many important structures. So what are the muscle structures which are there, which are deep to this gluteus maximus? So that is the second objective. So they might ask you as a short notes or something like that, and then you are supposed to write the structures. Like, so this structures might be the muscles, they might be the blood vessels as well as nerves, or bones and ligaments. All these are the structures which are deep to the gluteus maximus. So they are not only muscles, they are also blood vessels and nerves as well as the bones and ligaments. So we will study this one by one. First we will begin with the muscles. We have already seen these muscles. After we cut the gluteus maximus, this is the gluteus maximus muscle which has been cut to show the structures which are deep inside, which are below it. So thus the muscles you have already seen is the gluteus medius as well as the minimus. Then we have the piriformis here. Then we have the tricep tendon of the obturator internus. This is the obturator internus here, which you can see. Then we have the superior gemellus above this and the inferior gemellus. Then we have the quadratus femoris here below that, and we have the obturator externus on the opposite side, which we cannot see with this view, but still that is also a part of the muscle which is deep to this gluteus maximus. Then we have the muscles of the thigh, like the adductor magnus, the upper part of the adductor magnus, semimembranous, semitendinosus, as well as long head of biceps femoris, which will come below this here. Okay, so they are also part of them will also be covered by the gluteus maximus. That's why we have mentioned them here. Adductor magnus, semimembranosus, semitendinosus, as well as the long head of biceps femoris. So these are some of the structures which are deep to the gluteus maximus. These are the muscles which are deep to the gluteus maximus. There are also blood vessels and nerves which are deep to this muscle, gluteus maximus. So these are, one is the superior gluteal vessels as well as nerve. If you see the piriformis is a very important landmark to differentiate some of the important structures here. The structures which are coming above that will be called as the superior gluteal nerve and vessels. So here only the nerves have been shown, but imagine there will be also blood vessels by the side of these nerves. Okay, so this is the piriformis muscle, and just above the upper border of this muscle you can see the superior gluteal nerve. So this is the superior gluteal nerve, as well as there will be also blood vessels. Those will be the superior gluteal vessels. The vein and the arteries are also there, as well as the nerve. So which can be traced above the upper border of the piriformis. Below the border of the lower border of the piriformis, then we can trace a very important thick nerve. This is called as the sciatic nerve. As soon as you see, feel it, it will be a thick nerve which you can be easily identify. This is the sciatic nerve, the thickest nerve in the body. So this is the sciatic nerve which comes below the piriformis. From the lower border of the piriformis you can trace it. Along with that, there is also a very important cutaneous nerve. This is called as the posterior femoral cutaneous nerve. Just beside that there is one important nerve. This is the sciatic nerve which has been cut to show the deeper structures. So this is the sciatic nerve, and beside that we have a thick nerve. Even though it is cutaneous nerve, it is thick This is called as the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Along with that, there are also inferior gluteal vessels and nerve. Just like the superior gluteal nerve, there are also some nerves here. These are coming below the lower border of the piriformis. Those will be called as the inferior gluteal nerve, as well as vessels will be also there. Here, as I said, only the nerves have been shown, but there will be also vessels here. These will be called as the inferior gluteal nerve, as well as the vein and the artery. Now, after that, there will be a nerve called as the nerve to obturator internus. So we have already seen the muscle will be here. This is called as the obturator internus, and deep to that we can see a small nerve which will be coming, which will be which will be supplying this muscle, that is will be called as the nerve to obturator internus. Then we have the internal pudendal vessels as well as the pudendal nerve. We can also trace below this piriformis, there will be a nerve which will be coming. This will be called as the pudendal nerve. Along by the side of this nerve, there will be also an artery called as the internal pudendal artery, as well as the vein. Then there will be also some trochanteric as well as the cruciate anastomotic arteries which will be around this joint, hip joint. Okay, that can also be traced. So these are some of the important structures: the superior gluteal nerve as well as the blood vessels which are coming above the upper border of the piriformis. All other structures will be coming below the lower border of the piriformis, that is the sciatic nerve, the inferior gluteal nerve and vessels, the pudendal nerve as well as the internal pudendal artery. Then we can see the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh, as well as the sciatic nerve itself, as well as the nerve to the obturator internus, as well as the nerve to superior gemellus. All can be traced here. Apart from the blood vessels and nerve, we can also assign the bones as well as ligament which are present deep to this gluteus maximum. Those are, we have already seen, the ilium part of this is the hip bone. It is also called as the innominate bone. So it has three parts. This is the ilium. Then we have the pubis as well as the sacrum, the ischium as well as the pubis. The ilium, ischium as well as the pubis, and this is the sacrum is a separate bone. So you can see the three parts of the hip bone which are present deep to this muscle: the ilium, then we have the ischium as well as the pubis, then we have the sacrum which is separate bone, as well as the coccygeal bone, small 3 to 4 individual bones. Then we have the ischial tuberosity of the ischial bone. This part again, it is important, which is very prominent. Then we have the greater trochanter of the femur itself. So this is the greater trochanter which also comes deep to this gluteus maximum. So that also is a bone which is deep to this greater trochanter of the femur, as well as the sacrotuberous ligament. So this is the ligament which extends from the sacrum to the ischial tuberosity. This is called as the sacrotuberous ligament. So this ligament is also present deep to the muscle, as well as the dorsal sacroiliac ligament. So there are some ligaments which are extending from the dorsal side, that is the postal side of the sacrum, going up to the ilium. So these are called as the dorsal sacroiliac ligament, because there are also ventral on the front. So these are called as the dorsal sacroiliac ligament. So all these structures, the hip bone itself with the ilium, ischium and the pubis, then the sacrum, coccygeal bones, as well as these ligaments, as well as even the greater trochanter of femur, and this ligament, that is the sacrotuberous ligament, as well as the dorsal sacroiliac ligament. All these structures are deep to the gluteus maximum. So whenever they ask you the structures deep to the gluteus maximus, then you have to write the muscles, then the blood vessels, as well as nerves, as well as the bones and ligaments also. Now, studying in some detail about the arteries of the gluteal region. As we have seen, there are so many arteries, there are so many muscles, so these are supplied by many nerves as well as the arteries, because there are so many bundle of muscles there. So the gluteal region are supplied by three arteries coming into the gluteal region through the greater sciatic foramen. So here is the greater sciatic foramen, and this is the piriformis muscle, and beside the piriformis we can trace all these structures. One is the superior gluteal artery, which will be coming, as I said before, it will be coming from the upper border of the piriformis. Here also you can see, here this is the piriformis, and above that will be the superior gluteal artery, and below that is the inferior gluteal artery. So here also you can see, here this is the inferior gluteal artery. The third artery which will be supplying this gluteal region, muscles of the gluteal region, will be the internal pudendal artery. So these are the three arteries which will be supplying all the muscles of the gluteal region. These arteries are branches of the internal iliac artery. So all these three arteries are branches of the internal iliac artery, and these three arteries will be supplying all the muscles of the gluteal region. Coming to the nerves of the gluteal region, we have already seen. So all the nerves which are supplying this gluteal region are coming from the lumbosacral plexus. As I said, mentioned before, the lumbosacral plexus, and this lumbosacral plexus we will study in more detail when we study the thigh itself. So just remember now that all these nerves are coming from the lumbosacral plexus. And what are the nerves which will be present here? One is the superior gluteal nerve, which will be beside the superior gluteal artery, as we have said before, and this will be coming above the upper border of the piriformis, which can be traced there. And the inferior gluteal nerve, you can see here the inferior gluteal nerve coming along beside the inferior gluteal artery, which is also present here, will be present. And the third nerve is the sciatic nerve, the thick nerve. This sciatic nerve, it will be also there. And the fourth nerve will be the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. So this is the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh, and the fifth nerve is the pudendal nerve. And the next nerve will be the smaller nerves, the nerve to caudatus femoris, as well as the inferior gemellus, as well as the nerve to obturator internus, which they have not shown here, which will be present, will be the nerve to obturator internus, as well as the superior gemellus muscle. Okay, so all these muscles will be supplying, as well as they will be present in this region, in the gluteal region. Okay, so this is about the muscles of the gluteal region, their origin, insertion, action, and nerve supply, and the structures which are beneath the gluteus maximum, that is the muscles, the arteries, veins, as well as the nerves, as well as the ligaments, as well as the bones. Then we have studied the arteries as well as nerves which are present, as well as supplying the muscles of the gluteal region. Okay, this is all about the gluteal region. If you have any questions, you can write to me, and inshallah I will try to answer your question. Okay, thank you very much.